Hey guys, welcome to the channel. In today's video, we're going to be upgrading a previous drone that I built when I first started. This drone is an analog drone, and it was a budget build when I first started with a Black Mamba stack, the MK405 stack. It was, I believe, like the $40, $50 stack they had on sale for a while in race day quads. But I wound up, buying a bunch of analog parts before I switched to digital, and never used any of them. So I figured I'd do a build video for beginners. I would say it's from beginners all the way up to intermediate. So that's what this is. So in that first part, I was showing you the old ESC. This is going to be the new ESC that I'm switching to. It's an Akon 55 amp ESC, and it's going to be paired with the Zeee's F7 30x30 V2. And that's what that was. Also using the Mr. Steele run cam camera. It's the Mr. Steele edition, so it's got all of the settings pre-programmed in, I believe. Don't quote me on that, but I think the settings are already set that he uses. Also on the arms, we're going to be using the Zeee's LEDs. Those are going to go on each of the arms, and the flight controller actually comes equipped with 4 plugins, so it's pretty easy to install and you don't have to solder each wire up, which makes that very easy. That's the connections there, and these lights are bright. They also get pretty hot, so I definitely recommend, if you are going to use LEDs, these specific ones. It could be other LEDs that do it too, but these ones get pretty hot, so if you're gonna arm it and they're going to be on, I would definitely try to keep it in the air as much as possible and not let it sit too long. So with this, the placement is key, I think. I thought about putting it on the bottom, but it seems like it would work better on the sides of the arm, so that whenever it's up in the air, you can have a color for the back and a color for the front, and it'd be, you know, easier to fly line of sight for if you're showing friends or if you're showing kids, you know, trying to impress them with the lights on the drone and everything. It's easier to fly if you have the colors different. Red in the back, green in the front, something like that. We're going to go ahead and take the old motors off of the old ESC. That's what I'm showing here. After I take the motors off, I usually like to go back with a fresh solder bubble. That's just a habit of mine. I always do that no matter what I'm working on. If I go in with the solder gun, I always go back with a fresh bubble, and that it just makes it easier to solder back onto if I ever want to use that board again. So that's what you see me doing there. We got all the motors off, disconnected. We are going to be using those same motors, so if you know what, you probably don't need to know how to put motors on. It's usually 4 screws that go in. You just need to find the right length. When you're putting the screws in, make sure that you do not hit the motor windings with the screws when you're putting those in. Using a 35 volt capacitor, the Success Iflight, I believe this one, yeah, it goes up to 800 milliwatts, TBS Triumph antenna. And this is just all stuff that I unpackaged before this, and it's, you know, I think I tested everything out once off camera, and that was about it. So I'm gonna be new to this on the first flight, just like you would if you bought it. TBS Tracer is going in. This is the receiver that we're gonna use. It's made by Team Black Sheep. It's pretty much the successor to the Crossfire receiver. The only difference being that these are made more for racers. The latency is better, so the reaction time from when you move your sticks on the remote to when the drone actually does what you're inputting is very, very fast. I think it's 3 to 6 milliseconds or something like that. So that's why we're going to use that. They consider that the best today. And then Express LRS just came out recently too, and that is definitely going to be a competitor for Tracer. Using Iflight Zing motors, 2207 stator, that's going to be the motor size, and then the KV is 1800, and that's going to be rated up to 6S. So you can use a 4S, 5S, or 6S battery. It's probably not going to run like you'd want it to unless you use a 5 or a 6S, though. That's just from personal experience. All right, so what we're going to do now is we're going to dry fit the ESC in. I like to dry fit everything in before I, you know, go ahead and just start soldering things up, because you never know, you know, if you're going to be rubbing the top plate or if you're going to need a little bit more room in between things. So if you just start, you know, soldering things up without dry fitting everything, then you could run into problems. And that's just another thing from experience. I've, you know, built many of quads, and on the first five or so, I would say I've run into those kind of problems. So anyways, we got the ESC on. We plugged the flight controller in with the cable that came with the ESC. I also had to re-pin the ESC cable to match up with the flight controller. And this is exactly what I was talking about. So I ran into the problem where it was going to be too tight of a fit with these bolts that lock the thread screws I have in to hold the 30 by 30 mount on the flight controller. I had to take those bolts off. So that's what you see me doing there. So we have everything figured out. We got the ESC on. The capacitor is soldered up right with the positive lead on the positive side and the negative lead on the negative side. Make sure double triple check that and make sure that you got that capacitor right, because you'll have major problems if you don't. So this is me soldering the motors up. I'm gonna kind of move a little bit quicker to save time. So we soldered each motor up, and that green light you see there is a smoke stopper. You can get those on pretty much any FPV website. It's probably the best tool I have in my toolbox. It'll save you tons of money, and always make sure that, you know, you got a clean build and that nothing's going wrong. So that light stayed green when I plugged in. There are no LEDs on the ESC, so you can't really tell that that's on right now, but the green light means we're good to go. Next thing I like to do is I'll take a toothbrush and some isopropyl alcohol, and you can actually dip that in. Don't get it too wet, but it doesn't really matter if you get it too wet with that, but I like to dampen it and go back and just kind of clean up every solder joint that I made. So we got the flight controller on now. I also put the VTX, that Iflight Success VTX, the 800 milliwatt one, I put that in the back, and I got that situated now to the point where I got the antenna on. This is also an Apex mount. It's the Mr. Steele Apex frame, and it comes with this antenna mount where you can have the antenna mounted underneath the top plate, but that didn't work for me just because of the space, so I had to create a 3D printed mount off the back. And that's why you see the antenna going out the back. So now we're taking the wire harness that came with the BTX, and we're measuring the length of the wires to the flight controller. So general rule of thumb, whenever you're measuring wires to the flight controller, you want to give yourself an extra, I would say, about a half inch, because you're going to wind up wanting to twist those wires once they are soldered on before you plug that cable into the VTX, just to make the build nice and neat and tidy and no wires are sticking out and they can't get hit by the propellers. So you'll see me do that here in a second. Actually, right now I'm pre-tinning all the wires, which is definitely a good habit for, you know, anything you solder, no matter what. You're going to pre-tin both ends of what you're soldering. So the wire itself, you're going to pre-tin that, and then you're also going to pre-tin the pad that you're going to. And that, to me, is just, that's a must, because you're going to have a lot of problems trying to get that to stick to the pad if you don't have solder on both sides previously. So there we go with the pre-tinning on the VTX. Soldered that up pretty quickly. Everything looked clean. So now I got the camera going in. I screwed the camera to the two plates that came with the frame previously off camera, and I got that situated. And we went ahead and soldered that up. The camera is soldered up to the front of the board. The wires were pretty short, so that was pretty easy. So now we're going to go ahead and take these LEDs, which is just as simple as plugging them in. And here in just a sec, we're going to grab a battery and test that out also with the smoke stopper. So right here, I'm pre-tinning the pads for the tracer receiver. And it's the same thing as the VTX. So there's my receiver. It's the wires are soldered onto the receiver. You can look up wire mapping for, you know, any kind of receiver you have. And then I soldered it to the board. So one last check, we're gonna check this with the battery. Got a green light there. Can't see it, it's upside down, but there's the glow of the green light. Didn't turn red, didn't make a noise, which is good. The LEDs are on and everything's, you know, blinking the right way. It looks like everything worked out really well. So right now I'm pretty much just thinking about how I want to mount the LEDs, you know, mount them on the back of the arms, the side of the arms, the front, you know. So that's my thought process there. Here's a little overview, a little close-up of the drone if you wanted to screen grab that and check anything out. If you have the, you know, if you have these exact components, could be helpful for you. All right, so now we're going to need to mount the tracer antenna. So that tracer and the tracer receiver you see in the video, it's a used one, so that's why you see those antennas are a little beat up there. So all right, so I need to tell you this. So whenever you're mounting any antenna to carbon, you want to put something in between. So what I did was I put some double-sided sticky tape in between the actual antenna and the carbon just to not create any noise. So I went ahead and secured the LEDs. It's not the neatest thing in the world, but I secured those with some twist ties or some zip ties, and we're gonna check that out again because I like to check with the smoke stopper after each step I do, because you never know what you know. You could have knocked something out of place, you could have got a solder bubble that spread out to another pad and it's linking the two pads, so you just kind of want to smoke stop that thing all the way to the end. All right, so this is going to be the Betaflight configuration part of the tutorial. So what you're going to need is your quad that you just built, a USB-C or regular USB, depending on what flight controller you have and what it requires. In this case, it's USB-C, and so it doesn't stop the video I'm recording. I already have it plugged in and ready. So, but before this, when you plug it in, it'll automatically connect, or you'll have to hit connect up here. You'll have to choose your COM port. And based on what computer you have, you'll have to maybe download drivers, but I'll leave a link in the description to other videos that show you more about that. So, all right, so the first thing I do is I come in and I enable expert mode. Once that's enabled, we're just gonna move down this list on the left side over here. So set up, we calibrate the accelerometer, which makes it nice and level so that whenever you are in level mode, if you want that, it we'll keep it on track and from swaying left and right. So calibrate that, and that's about it on setup. So ports, in this section you have your serial RX, you have your MSP configuration. You will only use configuration MSP whenever you have DJI, or if you're using an HD quad with an air unit or a Caddx Vista. In this case I'm using a regular VTX, and it's analog, so we're not going to mess with that. It already comes pre-programmed on USB. And then on this side I have my receiver soldered to RX4 and TX4, which is UART4, so I went ahead and enabled that. And then I don't really mess with any of this stuff over here, but you can if you want to. You'd have to look up some more on that because I'm not actually sure what these do. Pretty sure. Okay, so it makes it to where you can put your ESC on a sensor if you have it wired up. So this is more for old school ways of doing things. Most up-to-date flight controllers and stacks won't require any of that. So, all right, cool. I was worried that the computer was gonna shut down from that. All right, or the recording. All right, so power, actually no, we're gonna go to configuration. This first thing is quad X. All this is the layout of your quad, the motor direction. So if we switch it up to 1, 3, 3, 4, it goes clockwise from left down. But the one that is default and what usually everyone uses is this one, which starts from the bottom right and goes counterclockwise. Actually, no, it doesn't. 1, 2, 3, 4, like that. Anyways, that's the default one. That's the one you want. D-Shot 600 is, so this is all ESC features. My ESC is D-Shot 600. You'll have to look in your manual to check that and see which one that you have. System configuration, this is already default. I wouldn't really mess with this if you don't know what you're doing, but this is what came with the flight controller, so we'll leave that. You can change your craft name. RSSI, I always turn that on if I'm using analog so that it can show me my signal with my remote. The next step you're going to do is you're going to move over here to receiver. Most of you will have a serial based receiver, which is S-Bus, Spectrum, FR Sky, or even Crossfire. In my case, I'm using Crossfire. If you're not, you're either going to be using Spectrum or you're going to be using S-Bus in most cases. So we'll choose Crossfire. And then other features. So this one, In my case, I'll have telemetry on because I want the telemetry to show in the goggles. LED strips for all the LEDs I have on this quad. Display LED screen display is going to be on if you have a high-tech fat shark goggles. I only have the Attitude V3, so I don't really need that on. Air mode permanently enabled is going to be the case for most of you, unless you want to perch on top of buildings, or if you want to stop on anything without bouncing, you'll have to turn that off. But that's more advanced. OSD on, dynamic filter on. D-shot beacon configuration. So this is if your quad gets lost or if you crash somewhere, you can't find it, you can program this to a button and the motors will beep to let you know where it is. And that's it on that one. So we'll save and reboot. And then we'll move to power and battery. That's going to be personal preference. I don't usually mess with that. Failsafe is already set with the default tuning. All right, PID tuning. So this is going to be your default PIDs that come with your flight controller. If you check out some tuning videos and want to get into that, it's pretty hard to figure it out if you're a beginner, but once you get the feel for a quadcopter, you'll be able to know what, after watching the videos, you can kind of feel, you know, what you need to do to tune this. And they've made it easier now where you can move sliders that move all of them at once instead of you having to type in all the numbers yourself. So, but I usually leave that at default because it's fine. The rates are going to be how fast your quad flips, rolls, and on the yaw axis. Then you also have a TPA for your throttle. The TPA we won't really mess with, but these are my rates that I use. The default rates are usually at 1.0. And I forget what these ones are, but these are the rates that I use. And to show you an example of what I mean, I'll plug in a battery here. All right, so this is about how fast you are at 1.7. And it's a lot slower on default, so. But that's something you can leave at default until you get used to it. If you are used to it, then you can mess with that and change that around. So we'll go ahead and save that. And I've done all these settings already before this just to save time, so kind of moving quickly. All right, so the receiver tab, this is gonna be important. This is gonna relate to your ports tab. So if you have the UART4 selected, if you have your right UART selected for your type of receiver that you have, it should show up in receiver. And that's what it's gonna look like. So in most cases, you're gonna come in and it's gonna be, the throttle will be on. Here, I'll show you. So you have an example. All right, so right now, your quad's gonna be flipping like that and you're not gonna know what to do. You're gonna search on YouTube for hours. I'll just go ahead and tell you how to fix it right now. So right now the roll, I'm moving my throttle up and down, but it's on the roll up there. So what we need to do is we need to take these four letters and remap those so that they're right for the type of controller we have. And first you can start off by going to the different settings they have. And then every time you select that, you're gonna hit save. We can go to default. We'll save that. So that one's not working. And then there's spectrum. Save that. All right, so that one stopped. But now the yaw, I'm moving my yaw left and right and it's on the roll. So that tells me that pitch is right. All right, so roll and yaw are gonna have to be switched. So that means we'll switch the A to an R and crap. Get that out of there. The TREA should be the right configuration for my quad. And that's, so now I'm moving throttle, yaw left and right, rolls right, and pitch is right. All right, so that's how you get that figured out if you do run into that problem. This blinking AUX4 you see here, that's the RSSI output of my controller. So I have it programmed to AUX4 and that's on right now. I just had to unplug the battery because it was getting hot. All right, so I have my channel set up, AUX1, AUX2, AUX3. So those three channels are going to be the what you hit for your modes. Other than that, if you don't see these meters jumping around, then the problem is most likely going to be either in configuration right here where it says crossfire and serial based receiver, you've done something wrong there, or in the ports tab, you've done something wrong with selecting the right UART. So everything's cool here. We'll save it. Move on to modes. So this is how I have mine set up. This is a personal preference as well, but we don't need to, let's see. Oh no, I don't need to plug in the battery. All right, so in order to do these, I'm just gonna exit these two out so that I can show you a couple. So to arm your quad, I want to set it up on a switch, but you might not know what that switch is. If it's aux 1, 2, 3, or 4, you don't need to, you can just press auto. And now you flip the switch you want and it automatically registers that one. So we're gonna move that all the way over so that when we are in the high position, it's inside of arm. And you can see the cursor moving over. Angle mode, I like to have angle mode on so that I can get out, or I can land line of sight if I need to really fast. So we'll do that on aux 2. So now I'll start off, when you're not in angle mode, there is no acro mode on here. That's just the normal mode of the quad whenever it comes out the box. So if you don't put any angle mode on, it'll automatically be an acro mode, which is where you can completely flip and then it's fully autonomous to what you're doing with the controller. So now I have aux 2 in the middle here. So whenever I flip this down one, I can land line of sight easier, or just use angle mode if you want to. And then if I go all the way down, because this is a 3 position switch, so that's the second position. And now third position is down here for the beeper. So on that same switch, aux 2, I have a beeper. And just to let you hear what that sounds like, it'll sound like this when you have the beeper on. And that'll be a beacon so that you can find it very easily. Other than that, the only other one you'll need is this one, and that's flip over after crash. So if you land upside down, you can activate that, and it'll spin the propellers the opposite way of normal, causing the quad to go from being on its back. You can choose to use the left side of it, the right side, front or back, so you can flip any way you want to. And I have that programmed to aux 3. So when I do aux 3, you want to put, you turn your aux 3 switch to high, and then you have to arm. And then after you do the arm, it'll be in turtle mode, which is flip over after crash, and you can use that to flip back over very easily. All right, so we'll save that. And that's pretty it for modes. All these other ones, you can mess around if you want to with them, but this is really all you need. In my experience, that's all you need. Adjustments, I don't ever mess with that. Servos, we won't mess with that either. The motors tab, so this is another important one. So in the motors tab, we're gonna check to make sure that our motors are working, first of all, and make sure that they're in the right spots. So you want one to be here, you want two to be there, and you wanna make sure that the corresponding motor that you choose here is spinning right on the quad. So in this case, you're gonna want to first take the propellers off. That's a must, because if you do not have them off, sometimes these quads can spin up and you can just plug it in automatically, and then you might have something configured wrong and the quad will just fly through the house and kill somebody. So you want to have the propellers off, plug your battery in. All right, after that, you're going to move over to this little section here. You're going to hit, actually, first you can calibrate the ESC. So to calibrate the ESC, you take the master slider. All right, you know what? I'm telling you wrong. You unplug the battery. Enable, I understand the risk, the propellers are removed. Enable that, and you're gonna turn this slider all the way up. And now plug in the battery. Don't worry, it won't take off on you. It'll just calibrate the ESCs. Now you move it down, and that's the third beep. All right, so we're gonna go ahead and start with motor one. Turn that up. You could also check here, this red line is kind of telling you if there's any kind of vibrations in your motors too. If you have a solid red line right there, then your motor's in good shape, and you can check those one by one if you want to. So after you select which motor you have, you want to make sure it's turning the right way. So I have motor one going clockwise, that one's right. You can also click on the one you want to do and then press the up arrow. to ease into it. You can just keep pressing it until you have the motor spinning freely. So now it's spinning freely. That one's going counterclockwise, so that one's right. So we're good there. And that's why you have your propellers off. I don't, and I just hit my finger. All right, so motor three is spinning counterclockwise as well, so that one's right too. And then motor four. All right, so that's the only one that needs to be changed. So that one is spinning the wrong way, and I'll show you how to take care of that in a second. So, all right, so other than that, if you have everything spinning right, everything is in the right, the motor mapping is the most important part, because if you go to turn up one, and one or two or three or four spins instead of the one that you chose, then your motor mapping is wrong, and it's going to cause the quad to just completely flip as soon as you arm it. And it'll drive you crazy for hours, but you'll know that it's motor mapping. And if that does happen to you and the motor mapping's off, you can go to Joshua Bardwell's page, which he has tons of videos on how to remap the motors, and that's something that you'll do in the CLI tab. All right, so moving on from motors. Oop. Actually, I forgot to tell you one thing. Unplug the battery, because if you don't, your VTX is going to sit there and it'll get very hot and it could ruin it. So, all right, so OSD, all this is just personal preference where you want all your stuff. This is how I have mine set up. In order to do that, you just click on what you need, which that one is battery usage, which is that bar. You scroll over and you can move it around. And I recommend putting your goggles on and plugging the battery in during this. And then when you move this, you can actually see it on the screen where it is. So you can adjust that accordingly. All right, so I'm gonna turn that one off because I don't use that. I have all these set up. If you wanna check a screenshot of it to see how I have these set up. These are show your stick lays. This is the throttle position. Mode I'm in, altitude, battery voltage, cell voltage. So this will tell you the average cell voltage. That is good to know, because if this is very low, that means one of the cells is going in your batteries and it could cause a fire. So I've had like three or four fires in my quads, and I never knew that you could put this up here and it'll warn you if one of those cells are going. This Celsius 33 degrees is the core temperature, so that also tells you if it's getting too hot. The amps that you're drawing, link quality for crossfire, and then RSSI. So once you have all that set up, you're gonna save that. All right, so next is video transmitter. You can actually configure this in a way where you can use your remote and goggles to change the channel of your quad. You can change the power, the frequency. I just set it to the highest it goes and I'd leave it alone, but that's up to you. And if you wanna do that, you would go grab a file from the internet for the type of VTX you have, save it to your computer, and then you're gonna hit load from file right here. And then it'll set up a table for you so that you can actually change that stuff at will when you're out in the field, instead of having to come to a computer every time. The next one is LED strips. So this one already calculated for me that I had 31 LEDs. I'm not going to go into this too much just because there's a lot of details, but I'll leave a link in the description for an LED video also where he just talks about nothing but that, and that'll help you out a lot, because I had to actually just watch that myself to get these ones to do what I wanted them to do. Sensors, I'm going to move my quad around a little bit on the table, and it'll show you, it'll just make sure the sensors are acting right, and it's the computer's reading what you do with the quad. Tethered logging and black box, that's another one to go to Joshua Barlow's page for. You can actually set up a flash to where when you fly, you can come back and you can dump your quad into the computer with a CLI, and you can actually see exactly what it's doing. So if you have a problem, it'll actually tell you exactly what happened when that problem occurred. And that's another cool feature of Betaflight. Other than that, I'm going to recommend that you do this. So you're going to go into CLI. This is going to be the last thing you do. Come down here, you're gonna click this, and then you're gonna type in DIFF, hit enter, and that's gonna be a dump of the current settings that you saved in here. And this is assuming you have everything working right, you've test flown it, and you like, you know, the settings that you have. So scroll up, What you'll do is you'll hit save to file, and I'm gonna save this to here, and this is gonna be, I'm gonna rename this one. You wanna put a name with it of the type of quad you're using. So I'm using an Apex frame, so I'm just gonna label that Apex, put it in this folder, hit save, and now you have a backup. Just in case something happens, you have to restore your quad, you have a backup of everything you just did. I think that's it. Other than that, oh, you know what? I need to show you one more thing. So we're gonna exit out of Betaflight. One last step, we're gonna go ahead and show you how to reverse a motor direction. So whenever we were in the motors tab earlier, I had one motor that was spinning the opposite direction. I believe it was motor number 4, which is this one back here. And in your case, most likely you're gonna have maybe one motor spinning the wrong way. It could be all 4. So this applies for all motors. So what we're gonna do is, the first thing you're gonna do is plug in the battery. Actually, the very first thing you're gonna do is download BL Heli Suite, or Fettec Configurator, or BL Heli Suite S. All those, I'll have links to all those in the description also. Once you have the right program you need, in my case it's BL Heli, we're gonna go ahead and plug in the quad with the battery. All right, wait for your startup beeps. Take your USB-C or regular USB, whichever one you're using, plug it into the side. You'll hear the computer accept it. All right, so now up here to this. All right, so this is BL Heli Suite 32. I'm gonna go ahead and choose my correct COM port, which in my case is COM 8. Not sure why, but COM 1 wouldn't work earlier, so COM 8 worked. We're gonna hit connect. All right, once you are connected, the screen should just, you know, not give you any warnings or any kind of signals. Then you're gonna hit check right down here in the bottom right. All right, so it said it found multiple ESC configurations, and we have 4 motors, so there's gonna be 4 ESCs. And ESCs are electronic speed controllers. In my case, I'm using the Akon AK32 4-in-1. It's a 55 amp 6S, so it's 55 amp capable. And it is able to take a 6S battery or below. It's showing up as everything good, no bad. All right, 1, 2, 3, and 4. All right, so everything's good. So we're gonna hit okay. So in my case, it was motor number 4 that we wanted to reverse. So we can go ahead and do that first. You're gonna see 1, 2, 3, and 4 down here in different colors. We're gonna select 1, 2, and 3, and that's gonna leave just ESC 4, and then right up here you're going to see motor direction. It's going to be second row at the top, and if you move this little slider over, that's reversed. And over here is bi-directional 3D. 3D is a whole nother story, so all you're going to need is either normal or reversed. It was normal, so we'll reverse that. I've already done it, so I'm going to actually leave mine back here to normal. Once you've done that, we're gonna go down here and hit write setup, and nothing to write because my ESC is already updated, so it doesn't matter for me. But right here it'll say write successful. You click OK, and now that motor or motors, if all your motors are spinning, or if say it's 3 and 4 or 1 and 2. So let's say it's 3 and 4. We're gonna click 3 and 4. So now those, both of them, all these settings will apply to both of those motors. So you can select the ones that you need done. Trying to get smacked?
You trying to get smacked?
All right, guys. Now to the final step. This is definitely the most fun part of everything. After all the hard work, after the programming, this is what we got. So we have a brand new drone. Another thing that you're gonna need, obviously, is a transmitter and some goggles. There's tons of videos out there that, you know, will show you budget transmitters, budget goggles. In my case, I have a Taranis QX7, and then I also got the Fat Shark Attitude 3s. Running the Tracer TX module on the back. It's a micro module that's gonna be talking to my Tracer receiver on there. So. The first thing you want to do is you want to turn on your radio.
there's a few videos out there on how to bind. You're gonna have to know how to bind your receiver to your radio. That's already done in my case. So always turn your radio on first before you turn the drone on, because sometimes you can turn the drone on and then the radio and it'll cause some kind of frequency to go through that'll cause this to fly away. So they always say turn this on first. Set it down. We'll come over here, we'll plug in our drone. Make sure. And it gave me an RX signal critical warning. That's because I'm so close to the drone. But anyways, everything sounded good. And rookie mistake I was about to make is not hitting record on the GoPro. So always make sure you hit record on your GoPro. And you can use anything you want. This mount is for a GoPro Hero 8. And I also have session mounts. You can really put any kind of camera you can fit onto a drone as long as it's secure and you got a mount for it. So we're gonna go ahead and hit record on here. We're gonna check the goggles. All right, so the goggles are showing, let me change the channel. All right, there we go. All right, guys, let's see what we got. All right, so I got the drone armed. One thing I like to do beforehand, check if it arms. We're good there. And I also will check the flip over after crash mode, the turtle mode. And that's our four switch down. Arm it. Now we're gonna check it. That's right, left, front, and back. All right, so we're good on that. Flipping into stabilization mode, that's good. All right, we're ready to hit the skies. You ready? So just so you know, there are some HD quads out there. You know, they're made by DJI. The only difference in our quad and an HD quad is gonna be the transmitter, the goggles, the receiver, and the transmitter can stay the same. It's the more so the goggles and the VTX. But anyways, if you wanna upgrade to digital after trying it out, I definitely highly recommend it. But today we're doing analog, and so far so good. This thing's running great. Ooh, bumped the ground there. All right, let's try to knife edge this tree for the video, and then we'll call it a wrap. And all right, so now we get to use the turtle mode, which is nice. Arm it, we're gonna go right. Actually, a cool trick one guy taught me before is if you wanna put it in turtle mode and there's a bunch of high grass around you, you can trim the grass around you. Like that, and then you can take off. All right, one last time. There we go. All right, ready? Yes, sir. Let's land it. Nah, that didn't work. That's it, guys. Everything was good. LEDs, I got them programmed right now to, let's check it out and see if it works. Yeah, when I hit the throttle, they get a little blue. And in level mode, they're supposed to do something too. So let's see if it does that. Oh yeah. They turn blue whenever I throttle. And that's a lost quad.
Where is your god now?
Just kidding. All right, guys.
There she is.
Oh yeah, always check and see if you're still recording, and I am, which is awesome because I crashed. We're gonna stop recording. I got some goggle view in here that you're gonna see in the probably the bottom right of the screen with this. The GoPro view, and then my camera guy, Jake, here helping me out, which has made this video turn out awesome. So big thanks to him. I hope you guys enjoyed it. And if you have any questions, feel free to comment, and I'll be, answer you within the day or the next day at the most. Thanks, guys.